Hallelujah. Glory to God. You know, this morning I just want to share something briefly with us that God laid in my heart for this season. And while all these were coming to me, I began to ask the Lord more about this particular message. And I'd like to title this message, The Key. The Key. Somebody say The Key. Somebody say The Key. The Key to a Healthy and Wealthy Life. The Key to a Wealthy and Healthy Life. I'd like us to turn to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Are you there? If you're there, say amen. If you're there, say amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. I'll begin to read from verse 7. Paul said, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. Hallelujah. Now let's move forward to 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. If you're there, say amen. If you're not there, say I'm not there. 1 Timothy, alright, we're waiting for you. Hallelujah. 1 Timothy chapter 6. I'll begin to read from verse 3. If any man teach otherwise and consent not to the wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing but nothing about questions and strife of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil, submission, perversing disputings of men, of corrupt minds, and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself. But godliness, somebody said, but godliness. Somebody said, but godliness. He said, but godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. But they which will be rich fall into temptation and snare, and into many foolish and awful lusts, and draw men into destruction and perdition. Verse 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. You know, I love this. You know, verse 10, 1 Timothy 6, verse 10. You know, a lot of people just, you know, quote it, and I believe that the early church actually somehow misinterpreted this particular scripture. And they tell us that, you know, they made people feel that it's bad to have money. Hallelujah. So a lot of them were living in poverty. They were living in penury. Hallelujah. And they actually felt that living in poverty and penury was actually godliness. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So when you have money, they feel that, you know, and they combine it with the scripture that Jesus spoke about, you know, that it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Now, there's a misinterpretation of those scriptures back in those days. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But I love it because a lot of people just go, they say, money is the root of all evil. Have you heard that before? Have you heard that before? They just say, money is the root of all evil. But the Bible is not saying that money is the root of all evil. It says the love of money is the root. Money itself is not the evil. But the love of money, hallelujah, brings about evil. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Because when you love money, you can do anything for money. You can kill for money. You can make rituals for money. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But is it not just by the way? Now, I told us I'm going to speak to us on the key to a healthy and wealthy living. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, you see, it's important that we know that God wants us to enjoy our everyday life. It's important to know that. In fact, I love Todd John that says that, behold, brethren, I wish above all things that thou may prosper and be in health. He said, behold, I wish above all things. Now, you see, when God speaks, it means every word that he says. When God speaks, sometimes we need to pay attention to the tenses. Because everything he says, he means it. He said, I wish above all things. All, that means above every other thing, my desire is that you prosper and that your soul be what? Oh, are you here with me? And that your soul be what? Be in health. That you prosper and be in health. That's the plan of God for us. That's the desire of God for us. But you see, I want to come from a dimension this morning. Because, you see, even though God desires that we prosper, and God desires that we be in hell, but you see, have you, as a believer, now I believe I have some real people in the house this morning. Have you found yourself in a situation whereby it looks as if you're not prospering, and it looks as if your health is failing you? Do I have some real people in the house? Do I have some real people in the house? Okay, you are, everything has been okay for you. Do I have from real people? Let me have a witness. You know that real people. You know, some people are spirits here, hallelujah. But you know, you are in flesh, you have some flesh, and you've been through, you know, some scenarios like that. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And you see, I tell people that, you see, life is fair. And what I mean, what it throws at you is what it will throw at me. Hallelujah. But our response to life is what makes life differs for each and everybody. Oh, somebody following me closely this morning. Our response. Now, if you observe the parable of Jesus that he spoke about the man that built his house on the rock and the man that built his house on the sand, the Bible says one built his own on the sand and another built his own on the rock. Now, what happened? He said, the next one, he said, and the storm and the winds came. Now, the storm and the winds did not come to only the man that had his house on the sand. Was that it? The storm and the wind also came to the man that built his own house on the rock. Now, that shows us that what happens to Mr. A is what will happen to Mr. B. You understand what I'm talking about? But our preparation and our response to the storms of life, to the issues of life, is what makes life differs for each and every one of us. Now, there are some people that have a lot of money. Oh, my God. You know, we live in a generation where we believe that, you know, it's true. Even the Bible confirms it. That money answers all things. He also went further. He said money is a defense. He said wisdom is a defense. Then he went further again. He said apart from wisdom being a defense, he said money is also a defense. Now money is good. Tell your neighbor money is good. Come on, tell your neighbor money is good. Oh my God, tell your neighbor, money, goodie, it's good. It feels good to have some money in your pocket. But have you observed that there are some people that are so rich, but you know, you see, underficial, because you're not close to that family, because maybe they are your neighbors, and you see the husband drive out in a very posh car, and you see also the wife driving, one wicked car, you understand? You see all the sons and daughters of the house, all of them are just cruising around, very giant house, palatial place, you understand what I'm talking about? And you feel, wow, I wish I came from that family. And somehow God helped you or opened up an opportunity for you to get a little closer to that family. Then you begin to observe some things and you discover that with all the money that they have, that there's no joy, there's no peace in that house. And I've come to discover from that, I just made my conclusion on that. Now you see, money may be good, but money cannot satisfy the longing of the soul. Money cannot bring peace. Money can guarantee your joy. Are you with me? Hey, are you with me? Because our perspective must change. Our mindset must change. You understand? Now, I painted that scenario for us, and somehow you will go to some slums, maybe in the city of Lagos or even in the city of Akure, and you see these people. You understand? The man owns an Okada. He has a wife and he has like 5 children, and you see all of them on one Okada, and you stand maybe by your own car in the petrol station and you wonder, I live in fortune now. Look at this level of poverty. And somehow God opened up a door also for you to get close to that family, and you find out that they drink curry in the morning, they drink curry in the afternoon, and they eat ever at night. But there's so much joy and so much peace in that house. Now, can you take a moment and observe the two? Because there is a key to a healthy and a wealthy living on the face of the earth. Now you may feel that those people that drink are in the morning, you understand? Now they are not, you understand? But you see, right where they are, I tell you, if they know those family that have a lot of wealth and there's no joy, there's no peace, and they tell them the poor family that can you exchange places? Can these people become poor and you guys take their place and become rich and begin to live like them? Hey, I bet it with you, they'll prefer to live where they are. Are you with me? Are you with me? Are you following me? Because I'm going somewhere this morning. Now life will always teach out the same thing to each and every one of us. But our response as believers must be different. Are you with me? It must be different. I love Proverbs 17 verse 22. Is that a merry heart? Though it good to the soul. Another translation says a merry heart is like medicine to the soul. And if I will write my own translation of the Bible, I will put it like this. That a merry heart is like Panadol to your body when you have a headache. Hallelujah. That's my own translation. Amen. And maybe I'll give it to the doctors. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Now, you will discover that, I know of a sickler. Somebody that is a sickler. I know sicklers are meant to be sick. Are you with me? That's why they are called sicklers. They said they are meant to be sick. I mean, they keep falling sick, coming out of, you understand? But I know this particular sickler, that even though he falls sick, but not often. He doesn't fall sick often like that. You understand? It's just once in a blue moon. And if you know the person I'm talking about, you can't stand around him. You understand? He's always laughing, he's always cracking jokes. You understand what I'm talking about? He has such merry heart. And while observing him, I discovered that one of the secrets of not even being a sickler, but not falling sick as often as other sicklers fall sick, is because no matter what you do, he's just enjoying himself. He's just enjoying himself. He's healthy. He's enjoying himself. No matter the situation that comes, he's just enjoying his life. Are you with me? And there is a key to this. Listen. Now, you see, the message that is coming this morning may look as if, is pastor asking us to slow down. That's not what I'm talking about. We have visions, we have drive, we have passions, we have goals. But there's something I want us to realize this morning, and that's in the text that we read from 1 Timothy chapter 6. The main text of this particular teaching is from verse 6. It says, but godliness with contentment